Welcome to a new episode of the whole Bible series. Today we're going to have a talk about the introduction to the book of Genesis. So let's start. Introduction to the book of Genesis. First, we'll start by nomenclature. In the Hebrew Bible, it's known as in the beginning, because this is the opening statement of the book of Genesis. But the word Genesis itself came from the Septuagint, which is a Greek translation of the Old Testament. Who is the writer? Prophet Moses. Where did he write this book? In Sinai Desert, and that was inspired by the Holy Spirit. What is the purpose of writing this book? At least we have three main goals. First, declaring that God is the creator and the judge of the world. Second, showing the deep love of God for the human race. And third, explaining God's plan for our salvation. And I talk a little bit about God's plan for our salvation as mentioned in the book of Genesis. In chapter 3, God said to the serpent, "And I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your seed and her seed. He shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise his heel." And this prophecy about Jesus Christ, when he comes, will stamp on the serpent, which is a symbol of the devil. And you notice the word here, Moses used the word woman and not man, because Jesus will be incarnated from a woman and the Holy Spirit, not through a regular seed between man and woman. Then God started explaining this plan to Father Abraham when he said to him, "In your seed, all the nations of the earth shall be blessed." Genesis 22:18, which means in one of your descendants gonna come the Christ, and he'll be the blessing to all people on the earth. There are further details about Christ in Jacob prophecy. Jacob, in his last days on earth, he started to give commandment to his own sons. To Judah, he said, "Judah is a lion will from prey, my son, you have gone up. He bowed down, he lied down as a lion, and as a lion, who shall rouse him?" Notice here that he referred to Jesus Christ as a lion. And that very consistent with what's written about Jesus in the book of Revelation. "Behold, the Lion of Judah has prevailed." Revelation 5:5. He talked about him being humble under the cross, about his death, and about his resurrection. Then he further elaborate and say, "The scepter shall not depart from Judah, nor a lawgiver from between his feet, until Shiloh comes, and to him shall be the obedience of the people." So all the kings who came from the tribe of Judah are referred to by the scepter. The king started by King David and his son Solomon, all of them carrying scepter. After some bad kings came worshiping idols, God permit them to be slave and taken as captive to Babylon for almost 70 years. When they came back, the Persian kings didn't allow them to have a king, but only judges. So here, the prophecy is very clear. The scepter refer to the kings, and the lawgiver refer to the judges. So it say, when there are no more kings and no more judges coming from the tribe of Judah, this will be the time when Shiloh or Christ or the Messiah shall come. And that happened after they came back from Babylon and they were under the rule of judges for some time. Then the Greek came and took over Jerusalem. Then the Roman came and took over Judea. And this was the time when Jesus came to the world. And he further elaborated in his prophecy and saying, "Binding his donkey to the vine and his donkey's colt to the choice vine. He washed his garment in vine, and his clothes in the blood of grapes." So you notice here he used two animals. One is donkey and one is donkey colt. The donkey is connected to the vine, while the donkey colt is connected to the choice vine. So donkey and donkey colt, this is exactly what happened with Jesus Christ in Palm Sunday. He entered Jerusalem riding in a donkey and a colt. In the biblical meditation, the donkey and the vine are symbol of the all Jewish nation, while the donkey colt is symbol of the church, and the choice vine is symbol of the blood of Christ, which is a communion. So he's saying God, when he come to the world, he will rule over the Jewish nation and also over the Gentile. His garment is of red color, as if he was in the winepress. And this, of course, a symbol for his passion and his suffering on the cross. Isaiah saw this in his vision, chapter 63, when he said, "And your garment like one who tread in the winepress." And Jesus will reply, "I have trodden the winepress alone, and from the people no one was with me," which meant I am alone, the one who's gonna make salvation. And without me, no one else can offer salvation to the human race. In the book of Genesis, there are so many references and symbols to Jesus Christ. Maybe the first one we see was in the Garden of Eden itself. That was the tree of life. Whoever eat from this tree shall live forever. And was the symbol of Jesus Christ, the source of life. And interestingly, in the book of Revelation, God said, "Whoever conquer, I will give him to eat from the tree of life." And that tree of life is Jesus. That's what we have as a communion. You eat from the tree, you eat from the communion, and you live forever. And that's why God sent Adam and Eve outside the Garden of Eden when they sinned. God didn't want them to live forever in sin. He planned to come and save him. Then later on, they live forever with him. A second example was the first sacrifice that God made in the Garden of Eden when he slaughtered a sheep and took their skin and covered Adam and Eve. Now they realized that an innocent animal has to die so they can survive. Another example was Noah's Ark. The same way Noah saved and his family through the ark, Jesus saved us through his cross. And as the ark was made of wood, the cross also was made of wood. And as the ark prevailed over water, Jesus saved us by the water of baptism. Then another example from the book of Genesis, we see in chapter 14 about Melchizedek. He is a king of peace, and he met Father Abraham when he defeated his enemy and came back. Father Abraham offered him tenth of whatever he got. And Melchizedek, the king of peace, offered him a sacrifice from bread and wine. Very unusual to his time. The sacrifices in Father Abraham's time were all animal sacrifice. But this person, this king, offered a bread and wine offering. And let's read what David said in his psalm about Jesus Christ. "The Lord has sworn and will not relent. You are a priest forever, according to the order of Melchizedek," or Melchizedek. Then comes the famous story of Father Abraham offering his son Isaac. So the same way Isaac carries the wood in his back, Jesus carries the cross in his back. Isaac walked for 3 days and came back alive. The same way Jesus was dead for 3 days and came back alive. Father Abraham offered his beloved son Isaac the same way God the Father offered his beloved son Jesus on the cross. And God forbid Abraham to complete the sacrifice of Isaac because it will not be acceptable. The only acceptable sacrifice that take away the sin of the people will be in the sacrifice of Jesus Christ. Another example from the book of Genesis about Christ is Jacob later. And we hear about this in Genesis 28 from verse 10 to 17. When Jacob was running to his uncle Laban, he had a dream. He saw the heavens open and a ladder connecting between the heaven and earth, an angel coming up and down on the ladder. This ladder was nothing but the cross of Jesus Christ, and the angel coming down and the victorious church going up to heaven with Christ. And of course, Joseph has a lot of similarity with Christ. We're going to talk about him in detail when we come to the part of Joseph. Also in the book of Genesis, we read a lot about covenant that God made with human. At least there are four covenants. One between God and Father Adam, one between God and Eve, one between God and Noah, one between God and Father Abraham. Between God and Father Adam, when he promised Adam to be the crown of the creator and the ruler, and one condition, not to eat from the tree of knowledge of good and evil. And unfortunately, our Father Adam didn't keep that covenant. With Eve, when he promised her one of her descendants will come and crush the serpent, which means crush the devil. And that took place when Jesus came, incarnated and crucified and resurrected. Covenant with Noah, when he promised him that he will save him and his family if he obey him and build the ark. And although there was no sign of rain, but Noah believed in God and took this huge ark. It took him almost 100 years to finish building the ark. And through the ark, Noah and his family are saved. And was a famous covenant between God and Father Abraham when he asked him if he walk in his path and be perfect before God, he will bless him and bless his descendant, be like the stars in the sky and like the sand in the seashore. For classification of the book of Genesis, we can classify it into four categories. From chapter 1 till chapter 4, Father Adam till Abel's death. Chapter 5 till chapter 10, the story of Noah, Ark, and the flood. Chapter 11 by itself, the Tower of Babel, a very important event. And from chapter 12 till the end, Father Abraham and his descendant until the death of Joseph. Something that we have to notice in the book of Genesis, big difference and contrast between the beginning and the end. The beginning, God gave life to the world, while the end is death and burial of Joseph in Egypt. So the beginning is life, while the end is death. And if you ask ourselves what happened between the beginning and the end, it's only one word come to the picture. It's sin. And through sin came death. And that's why the beginning is happy, but the end is sad. As St. Paul said in his epistle to the Romans, the wage of sin is death. I think that will conclude our introduction to the book of Genesis. I'll see you next week. Thank you for your attendance.